So good afternoon. I'm John Eibner from Christian Solidarity International, and welcome to this public discussion of the challenge of Islamic extremism to religious freedom in the post-Islamic state world. This independent civil society event takes place parallel with the State Department's second ministerial for the advancement of religious freedom, which concludes in Washington this evening. There is a myth in circulation that Islamic extremism has died or is on its deathbed, together with the defeat of the ISIS caliphate in Syria and Iraq. This myth has been fueled by the suspension over the past year or two of Sunni Islamist terror attacks in the United States and Europe. But Islamic extremism is very much alive and well in the world, claiming the lives of citizens and denying religious freedom and other human rights across much of the globe. I'd like to identify just a few of the most deadly living manifestations of Islamic extremism. In Syria, ISIS has been pushed underground, but Al-Qaeda and associated jihad groups remain in control of religiously cleansed Idlib province in the northwest. In Nigeria and much of Western and Central Africa, Boko Haram and similar jihadist militias control huge swathes of territory. The horrific Easter bombings of churches and tourist centers in Sri Lanka reminds us of the continuing capacity of Islamist terror groups in Southern Asia. I have mentioned so far only non-state actors, but there are two states that are animated by and exporters of Islamic extremism: the Wahhabi Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and the Islamic Republic of Iran. The conflict between these two politically and religiously intolerant states for hegemony in the Islamic world has the potential to draw the United States and much of the world into a catastrophic war, one that is unlikely to advance human rights and human dignity. With these introductory remarks behind us, I would like to introduce our two distinguished speakers. On my left is Professor Habib Malik. Professor Malik is an associate professor in history at the Department of Humanities at Lebanese American University and a member of the Hoover Institution's Working Group on Islamism and the International Order. He was awarded a PhD in modern intellectual history from Harvard University. Dr. Malik has lectured widely in both English and Arabic on topics that include the history of ideas, Kierkegaard, existentialism, human rights, and the plight of the native Middle Eastern Christian communities. He has published three books and numerous essays and scholarly articles on these and other subjects. Among them is Islamism and the Future of Christians in the Middle East, published by the Hoover Institution just on the eve of the Arab Spring uprising. It's well worth reading. Bishop Michael Nazir-Ali was the 106th Bishop of Rochester. He served there for 15 years until 2009. Previously, he served as Bishop of Raiwind in Pakistan and as General Secretary of the Church Missionary Society. He's originally from Southwest Asia and was the first diocesan bishop in the Church of England born abroad. Bishop Michael was a member of the House of Lords, where he was active in a number of areas of national and international concern. He has both a Christian and Muslim family background and is now president of the Oxford Center for Training, Research, Advocacy, and Dialogue, Oxtrad, based in the UK. Bishop Michael's interests have led him to research and study comparative literature, comparative philosophy of religion and theology at the universities of Oxford and Cambridge, among other academic affiliations. He is the author of 13 books and of numerous articles on mission, ecumenism, the Anglican Communion, and the relations of people of other faiths, particularly Islam. And let us start our public discussion with remarks that will last about 15, 20 minutes, From each of our speakers, we'll start with Professor Malik, and then we hope that after these observations, we'll hear something from those in the audience. Professor Malik, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Eibner, and thank you, CSI, for organizing and hosting this gathering today. As a preface to my remarks, I'd like to start with what to some will sound like a controversial proposition. In the Middle East, the ultimate, abiding, central issue or challenge or cause, if you like, is not Palestine, it is not oil, it is not geopolitics, it is not development, it is not prosperity. All of these are very important issues that are alive and quite daunting, quite challenging. But I submit to you that the real underlying and persistent challenge that we face in the Middle East is the freedom deficit. The freedom deficit. In a freedom-starved part of the world, and that is the Middle East. Now, where does this come from? Why is this area suffering from a stubborn and persistent freedom deficit? Again, I submit that one of the underlying reasons, if not the main one, is that within the predominant religion in the region, namely Islam, there continues to be a living tradition of that can only be defined by the violent rejection of the different other. And this tradition dates back centuries, has taken on several permutations, and one can say that it might have had its beginnings with the Hanbali school of Islamic Sunni jurisprudence, and after all sorts of, as I said, permutations, it gave us ISIS. Now, when I say this, let me just be clear about one thing. The threat of radical Islam's violent rejection of the different other, while still very real with us, is this living tradition within Islam, and it is not necessarily geographically expressed. Geography, as Dr. Eibner gave us a quick survey of the geographic regions these days where this tradition manifests itself, geography comes and goes, shrinks and expands. Right now, ISIS geographically, the caliphate is not there physically anymore, but the ideology persists. So if we have transcended ISIS 1.0, there is still ISIS 2.0, 3.0, 4.0, etc., to emerge. And emerge it will, under different names and in different contexts, and perhaps different geographies. But guess what? It is there with us in cyberspace. It is there with us in prisons. It is there with us among shadowy groups that harbor resentment and seek revenge. So that's essentially the underlying cause of the freedom deficit in my estimation. Now, I come from a small country of Lebanon. And Lebanon is a multi-sectarian state. And let me tell you, Lebanon suffers literally from a million problems, one followed by six zeros. But remarkably, if not miraculously, Lebanese society continues to be by far the freest in the Arab world. And so then the question arises, why? How come? And the blunt answer is because Lebanon continues to harbor the last remaining free native Christian community in the entire Middle East. So the operative word here is free, freedom. And there are many Christians in the Middle East. The vast majority of them, at one point or another in the last 1,400 years, have succumbed to dhimmi status, which means to a kind of subordinate second-class status that has robbed them of their freedoms. Lebanon's Christians, at a great cost to their well-being, in terms of blood and in terms of resources, have managed over the centuries to preserve an impressive amount of freedom. And that's the Lebanon we are dealing with today. So yes, the political class is hopelessly corrupt. The country suffers from, I don't want to go through the whole list because literally it's a million problems. But the point that distinguishes this tiny troubled nation on the Eastern Mediterranean is that it does continue to harbor this free Christian community. Now, let me also say something else. We've observed that when Muslims live side by side and interact continuously with free Christians, the Muslims over time change and change for the better. When they live side by side and interact continuously with dhimmi or unfree Christians, they don't change. And this is empirically demonstrable. If you look at Egypt as the example of the latter type, you can see what I'm trying to say. So it's very important to underscore this point about freedom. And it is not a theoretical point. It is represented by a living and embattled community. Now, it's also important to remind ourselves that the victims of Islamic extremism are not only non-Muslims and not only Christians. There are also other Muslims who tend to be perceived by the militants as being traitors to the faith, as having somehow turned their back on Islam, or at least the kind of Islam that is understood by the radicals. That's another important point to maintain. Now, there are many dangers facing a country like Lebanon. And it is important, I think, to, again, not think in terms of geostrategy or oil or anything like that. But if freedom is important, it needs to be preserved where it has stubbornly persisted. And to do that, Lebanon, the dangers threatening freedom in a place like Lebanon need to be understood and guarded against. Lebanese have become used to the fact of life, of waking up every morning and knowing that the future is uncertain. We live with uncertainty. And right now, this is a juncture in history where there is lots of uncertainty about whether all-out war and conflict would break out in the region, given the tensions between the West and Iran and so on that you're all familiar with. Should we come to that scenario, it would be, I think, very important for any friends that Lebanon has around the world to try their best to make sure that Lebanon is spared complete and total destruction. And that would mean trying to avoid the scenario of the return to the Stone Age, which we hear a lot about. Which is very easy. In one afternoon, it can be done by a few Israeli planes. Take out the airport, the port, the electricity, the water, and that's it. That's not a solution for the challenges facing Israel or the West. There are specific addresses in Lebanon that can be addressed and dealt with without bringing down the whole edifice and therefore losing whatever is preciously there, which is this freedom. So that would be the first, perhaps, looming danger. Another one is the question of numbers. Now, there was a time when the balance between Christians and Muslims in Lebanon was slightly in favor of the Christians. That has gone over time, and today, I mean, constitutionally, in terms of practice, the if you will, the mythology of 50-50 persists because it makes sense from a stability perspective, right? And so the parliament is 50-50 among Christians and Muslims, so are the cabinet posts and so on. But the reality on the ground is that it's more like one-third, 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 meaning one-third Christians, one-third Shiites, and one-third Sunnis. And the numbers issue, I'm going to say two things that are actually not contradictory, but they complement each other. The first one is actually that apart from clashing assessments, and lest it be thought that everything rests on numbers, which it doesn't, the native Christian communities in the Middle East, for example, enjoy intrinsic value as a unique leaven for freedom, both actually as in Lebanon and potentially as in other parts. A fact that is entirely independent of their numbers at any given point in time. So from the perspective of the value of a free community, it doesn't matter how big or small it is. It's still valuable and should be preserved. Therefore, if the most pressing cause in the Middle East, as I just submitted to you, boils down in the final analysis to this question of freedom and how to redress the glaring region-wide freedom deficit, you know, all the other things that I mentioned is what you hear in the news all the time, Palestine, oil, etc. But you don't hear much about freedom. If this is in fact the issue, then free and rooted native Christianity must be preserved at all costs, regardless of demographic fluctuations or the shifting minority-majority calculus between Christians and Muslims at particular historical junctures. That's the first point about numbers. Now, the second point, of course, is it would obviously help a lot if the numbers can be somehow increased and if the balance, the imbalance, can be somehow redressed. And the way to do this, or the first place, I think, to start by doing this is everybody knows or should know that Lebanon today, a country of hardly 5 million people, contains about 1.5 million Syrian refugees, the vast majority of whom are Sunni Muslims. And they often live fairly close to the Syrian border, but on the Lebanese side. And they receive aid from abroad, but there is very little willingness by anyone in the international community to actually repatriate them to safe areas in Syria. Syria can basically contain 18 Lebanons. And about 90% of Syrian territory is peaceful, is quiet. Certainly the areas on the Lebanese border. And so moving them to the other side and continuing to help them would actually be win-win in the sense of helping these unfortunate refugees, but also doing it inside Syrian territory and therefore relieving Lebanon of this added burden. So that's something important in terms of the numbers issue. But economic improvement in Lebanon will also start to attract those young people who have left the country. They might start to come back and find opportunities back home, and others who have not left will think twice before leaving, if that could also be a pathway to help the tiny country. So the numbers issue, while on the values level, I submit, is not crucial. Wherever there is a free and vibrant nucleus of a living society. It doesn't matter how big it is demographically. But if the challenges of demography can also be addressed in parallel with this, that is not a bad idea. And to end this point, again, it is demonstrable that a healthy pluralism, because you know everybody in Lebanon, if you think about it, is a minority. No single group in and of itself is above 50%. And therefore, some arrangements have to take place for governing to occur. A healthy pluralism, it's been shown, will help offset radicalization. And so that's why it's important. A third point is Lebanon's strong feature over several decades, actually going back to the 19th century. And that is that Lebanon is a regional educational hub. And this is mainly thanks to Protestant missionaries who came in the 19th century, but also to Jesuits. So there was a kind of a healthy competition between the two that produced some of our finest universities. But it wasn't just for Lebanon. These universities attracted regional students who then went back to their countries as ambassadors of liberal ideas, of openness, of a better understanding of the outside world. And I think any help or any investment in trying to help a place like Lebanon would do well to direct it to the educational sector. Let me end, because we can, you know, take up many of these ideas. Let me end by saying that freedom, openness, liberal education, getting away from the tyranny of numbers, all of these will in the long term dilute, if not begin to challenge very severely radicalization. And the last point I want to make is a country like Lebanon is a, given how heterogeneous it is, we have 18 separate sects, both under the two umbrellas of Muslim and Christian, and of course one of the 18 is a Jewish community, recognized in our constitution. The best way to accommodate this kind of heterogeneity would be a creatively devised federal structure. And Lebanon today is de facto federal. It needs to be moved to a de jure. We can get into the details, but I'm not going to right now. But this, again, would be a proposition. Federalism will go a long way to offset radicalization as well. Unfortunately, the word federal is completely misunderstood in the Middle East and in Lebanon. It's equated in people's minds with fragmentation and with disintegration, which is, so education becomes very important here to try and explain what federalism is all about. I think I'll stop right here, and I thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much, Habib, for that fascinating Lebanese perspective on the question at hand. I'd now like Bishop Michael Nazir-Ali to share his observations. Of course, he comes from a part of the world where there has not been a long tradition, historic tradition of free Christianity, and that is the norm throughout most of the Islamic world. Of course, Lebanon is something of an exception. Bishop Michael.
Thank you very much. it's a great honor to be speaking alongside Professor Habib Malik, and of course, we should remind ourselves in this place and at this time of the contribution of his distinguished father to the whole issue of human freedoms, and particularly Article 18 of the Universal Declaration on Human Rights. So I'm so glad that the son is following in the footsteps of his father.
Thank you.
Of course, religious freedom or freedom of religion and belief is challenged on a number of fronts. I think we can accept that, and we have heard, I wanted to say ad nauseam, but that's probably not the right term, in the last 2 days, the different ways in which it is challenged. However, our focus today is on the challenge to it from the side of Islamist extremism. And I want to begin by noting, first of all, that Islamic resurgence has been a fact in our world for the last, 60, 70 years. And this resurgence is not wholly negative. You know, there are some positive features to Islamic resurgence. For example, people have come to a fresh awareness of their tradition, of their literature, of their history, to which Christians have made a signal contribution, particularly from Syria and Lebanon. And I know of people in other parts of the world, Nahdlatul Ulama, the great Indonesian society, which has been a voice for moderation in Southeast Asia, the work of Chandra Muzaffar and Anwar Ibrahim, possibly the next Malaysian prime minister, I don't know, have been part of the resurgence, but at the same time, voices of moderation and for greater freedom in their societies. However, if we were honest, we would have to say that a large part of the resurgence has been backward-looking, looking back to the 7th century, without any sense of adaptation to the modern world. Professor Malik has just referred to Ibn Hanbal, but I think it goes further back. I think the takfir wal hijra, you know, to pronounce somebody kafir and then leave, goes back to the Kharijites. You know, this goes very far back, almost to the origins. And I think we have to acknowledge this. Now, one of the features of this aspect of the resurgence is, of course, hostility to the West as the source of all the ills of the Muslim world, a hostility to the very existence of Israel, but also, and this is our focus today, a hostility to any form of Christian belief, presence, and practice. I found the remarks that Professor Malik made about the dhimma very interesting, because I think there is such a thing as a dhimmi mentality that has been created in whole populations and is being created even today. This is not just something in the past. For example, in Pakistan, circumstances are conspiring to create a dhimmi mentality in the Christian population and also other non-Muslim groups. Of course, there are Islamist organizations, and I know people in them, who have said either that they have given up violence. So when the Ikhwan al-Muslimin, the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, said they had given up violence, I believed them. Until the events of that night, you remember, when churches were burned, the houses of priests were attacked, and many people lost their lives. And I said, well, what kind of giving up of violence is this? Then there are other organizations like the Tablighi Jamaat in Pakistan, for instance, who say they are nonviolent. Now, you kindly said that I was the Bishop of Raiwind, and the present Bishop of Raiwind is also present here. So maybe he will say something about that. But one of the things about our diocese, Bishop, isn't it, that it is the center for the Tablighi Jamaat. And each year they have a convention. When I was the bishop, maybe people can guess, how many Muslim missionaries came to this convention? Any guesses? Have a guess.
John?
No, I don't. What is that of our misery?
No, no, it's not misery. It's 2,000. Very good. Any further? It was 800,000 in my time. Bishop Azad, what is it now?
Oh, I think it's well over 100,000.
Well over 100,000.
100,000. A million, you mean a million. Sorry, I mean 100,000 would be a great improvement, but so it's a million Muslim missionaries from all over the world come to Raiwind every year. Now, the Tablighi Jamaat say they are non-violent, and I believe them. But the question is, and this is a key issue, which also came up in the ministerial, to what extent can non-violent extremism result eventually for some people in violent extremism? You know, that the that's the question. I mean, I'm not saying that everybody is involved, but how many can be? Then there is the question of democracy. This was touted during the Arab Spring, the whole question of democracy. But what is the ultimate test of democracy, you see? I had a very distinguished teacher who was also an Anglican bishop, Bishop Kenneth Cragg. You may have heard about him. He is highly respected by Muslims as a scholar of Islam, I mean a Christian scholar of Islam. He was once asked by a journalist, we are in the press club here, the journalist said, Bishop, you are such a respectful student of Islam. In the end, what is the difference? So Bishop Cragg thought about it, and he said, in the end, the difference is in the attitude to power. The attitude to power. So Islam, I don't just mean extremists, but Islam generally, political Islam, believes that you change the world by taking power. Christianity teaches that you change the world by giving it up. You see. So the test of democracy is the giving up of power, not the acquisition of it. So if you take power at the ballot box, okay, that's fine. But are you then willing to lose power at the ballot box? I mean, that is the ultimate test. The second thing about democracy is that it is not enough. Democracy, I mean, I say this here in Washington, democracy in itself is never enough. Because in itself, it can become a tyranny of the majority. This is no less tyranny because it is a tyranny of the majority. So alongside, I was saying this during the Arab Spring period, that alongside democracy, you also need some other safeguards, particularly for minorities, for groups like women, for instance, maybe heterodox, so-called heterodox Muslim sects like the Ahmadiyya in Pakistan, or even groups that are not Muslim like the Baha'i in Iran and so on. Now, this kind of Bill of Rights approach is absolutely essential if we are going to have democracy in the Islamic world or indeed anywhere else, I would say. So what would such a Bill of Rights have? It would have a commitment to one law for all. Not different laws for different people, one law for all. The idea of common citizenship rather than dhimma. I mean, not just formally, but actually, you see. Common citizenship. I'm not a fan of President Sisi, but I have noted that since he came to power, he has consistently emphasized common citizenship for the people of Egypt. And well, we need to hear a lot more about that. The equality of women, of non-Muslims, et cetera, would also have to be recognized in such a Bill of Rights. I mean, of course, such a Bill of Rights may be different to some extent in different places, of course, taking the context into account. And nevertheless, we need something like that. Now, there are some mythologies around. Professor Malik was talking about some myths. I also want to mention them. One of the myths that we heard about a lot in the last 2 days was that economic circumstances, poverty, creates terrorism. This is a myth. If we look at the architects of Islamist extremism and terrorism in the world, they are not poor people. They are sometimes wealthy people, but very often professional people. I mean, Ayman Zawahiri is a doctor. There are engineers. There are, you know, technologically well-educated people, people with resources, people with skills. I mean, the skills of Daesh, of the Islamic State on the web was quite remarkable, you see. So, I mean, these are, we have to say that. It is true that these people then recruit from those who are disaffected and marginalized. So for the first time in history, you have large numbers of young men in the cities of the Middle East, in Cairo, for example, or in Algiers, who have had enough education to know that they are not getting what they think they should be getting. So of course, they are fodder for recruitment. In the same way, in the rural belt on the borders of Pakistan and Afghanistan, poor parents had no choice, but especially because of the failure of the educational policies of the government of Pakistan. Poor people had no choice but to send their children to the madrasas run by the ulama. And this is why the word Taliban exists. I mean, Taliban where? In the madrasa. So again, these people were recruited and radicalized. The second myth is that there will be freedom if there is a true Islamic state. I mean, we are repeatedly assured by eminent political Islamists that this is the case. Even some Christian leaders, Archbishop Rowan Williams, the former Archbishop of Canterbury, said this on one occasion, that if there were to be a true Islamic state, Christians would be free. Well, I beg to differ. I mean, there is no historical evidence for this whatsoever anywhere in the world. And if there is, I would quite like to hear it. 80%, it was said in the last 2 days, of those who are being persecuted today in the world are Christians. Rahman Chishti, a friend of mine, Muslim member of parliament in England, says that 80% of those are in the Islamic states of one kind or another, you see. But in the last 2 days, we have not had a proportion about this. Of course, Buddhists in Tibet are being persecuted, and of course, we should be very concerned about what is happening to the Uyghurs in China, the Baha'is in Iran, and so on. But there has to be some proportionality about this. I want to be quite blunt on this matter. And there has not been, and there is not. The other point to make in the light of what's been happening the last few days is that we are not simply talking about outbreaks of persecution. Of course, they are important. I mean, we should be concerned wherever human beings are suffering for what they believe in. But we are talking about a systemic issue. We are talking about a system, a political, social, and economic system. You may call it political Islam, but it's not just political Islam. It's also economic, it's also social. That is what we are talking about, and the suffering that is caused to groups like women. When I was a priest in Lahore in Pakistan, we cooperated with mainly Muslim women to make sure that General Ziaul Haq's program of Islamization did not curtail the already slender rights that women had in Pakistan. So this is a systemic issue which affects a very large number of people, including many Muslims, whether they are women, whether they are Sufis, whether they're Shia, depending on a Sunni state, or Sunni depending on a Shia state, as in Iran. Now, of course, there are many examples that can be given. I'm so glad that Professor Malik has given the example of Lebanon. but the examples of Iraq, of Syria, of Pakistan, of Egypt, of Iran are all there, and many of you know much about each of them. Northern Nigeria, I mean, the greatest number of Christians being killed today, and, you know, if we talk about numbers, is in Nigeria. So what can we do? I want to sort of end with that so that people have time for response. There is first, I think, an individual response. We cannot escape our responsibility, the responsibility of each one of us to respond to the situation. We can't just thrust it onto other actors. So individually, it is possible for many people, particularly in the Western world, but also in some parts of the Islamic world, to be advocates for those who have no voice of their own, who are suffering because of the system that political Islam is creating in so many parts of the world. Secondly, it is essential for people to keep going. You know, a few, what was it, 2 years ago or so, I went to Syria again, and the British government did everything to prevent me from going. Why? Maybe because they thought, and it's true, that I would discover the truth, which to some extent I did. I mean, only partially, of course, but more than if I had not gone. And I went from Lebanon through your peaceful border. I mean, no problem. So going is very important. And advice from the Department of State or the Foreign and Commonwealth Office and for people not to go should be taken very often with a pinch of salt. I mean, if you read the advice on Pakistan, you would think there is a terrorist around every corner. But this is not the case. Even Iran, at the height of the President Ahmadinejad's government, I mean, you know, Bishop Azad, who's now the Bishop of Rivand, was the bishop in Iran at that time, and we have traveled, haven't we, Bishop, to many places, including the holy city of Qom and so on. So going is very important. Find out for yourself. Don't just accept what other people tell you. Giving to those agencies that are working for greater freedom is important, because they are very often on shoestring budgets and they need our support. This is not a plug for Christian right. Solidarity International, but of course, you know, you are in that category. yeah, of course. You are here, yes, I can see that. Giving, advocacy, going, and of course, from a Christian point of view, but this may be shared by other people, prayer. Not everything is in our grasp. You know, we depend on a higher power to deliver the justice that this world needs. So that's the individual level. Secondly, we as communities need to act. So the churches, there has been a deafening silence about Syria from the churches. Why? You know, I'm not saying that the churches should all say the same thing, but to draw the attention of the world to the destruction of a very important center of civilization, all right, let's put it like that, at the very least. Our communities need to be committed to be advocates, to give, to go, to act. And then, of course, there is the state, the responsibility of the state not to reward extremism, not to reward it. And they cannot be selective about this. They cannot say, we will not reward one kind of extremism in one country, but we will reward other kinds of extremism in other countries. I think it was John who just mentioned the two kinds of extremism that are such a danger to the Middle East at this time, whether of the Wahhabis of Saudia or the Shia of Iran. So there are different kinds of extremism, but we have to at the same time point out what the dangers are and not to in any way to reward them. So don't sell facial technology to China, we've heard. Okay, fair enough. But what about the most sophisticated technology being sold to Saudi Arabia to bomb the poor people of Yemen? You see. There has to be a level playing field about this. Then there are other things that can be done. For instance, many states and groups of states have most favored nation arrangements with many countries. And yet, at the same time, they claim to be committed, these groups of states like the European Union, to liberty, to human rights, and so on. But it never seems to affect their granting of most favored nation status to countries that are clearly repressive. You see, why can this not be a feature, that most favored nation status will not, GSP, I think too it's called in the European Union, will not be given without adequate regard to what the state is doing with regard, with respect to minorities, to women, and other groups. There has to be a political will, of course, to do this, and in some cases, political favoritism has been shown by suspending the need to show respect for human rights before the award of most favored nation status to particular countries. I can give you examples if you wish. And then, of course, there is the international community, the United Nations, and the particularly the periodic review on human rights that takes place by the Human Rights Council. It is a very important forum where these matters should be raised. Very often it is the NGOs that are raising them and not member states. Good for the NGOs, but not so good for the member states. So I think that's the situation as I see it, Mr. Chairman. And those are some of the things that I think all of us could play a part in doing. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much, Bishop Michael. What I'd like to do is to take the liberty of putting the first question to our two guest speakers, and then hopefully we can get some good feedback from those in the audience. Each of you used an interesting, or two different interesting expressions. One was Habib Malik spoke about the violent rejection of the other as a century-old tradition. Bishop Michael spoke about an attitude to power, an ancient, well-embedded attitude to power that fuels and facilitates and drives forward Islamic extremism. But we heard at the ministerial many times, those of us who were there, we heard suggestions that we were on the threshold of a huge breakthrough, that there are various interfaith dialogues going on in different parts of the world. People are meeting together. A major evangelical delegation recently met with Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman in Saudi Arabia. And this is the kind of subtle messaging that is persistently, it's subtle, but it's persistently being conveyed now by the State Department and at the ministerial. And I wonder what each of the speaker thinks about this potential breakthrough. Are we there? And if we are there, what do we need to just push it that little bit further to make it a reality? Or if we're not there, how do we react to this reality of it still being a very long time before the scourge of this violent Islamic extremism is finally put to rest? Habib, why don't you speak first?
Well, I think there's a disconnect between what goes on in religious dialogue conferences and what's happening out there in the real world. Where you have people seething with hatred, rushing into the streets to defend blasphemy laws and what have you. The problem is there are very well-meaning people who are highlighted by the media who give the impression that what Dr. Eibner just said, we're on the threshold of a breakthrough. And they, as I said, they're well-meaning, and probably their interlocutors give an accurate impression of that. But their interlocutors do not represent the rank and file out there. Let me just also say that the vast majority, in my view, of Muslims are peaceful people who want to go about their day like everybody else. The problem is we have a vocal, violent few who basically intimidate the others into silence and pretty much set the agenda. And that doesn't come through at these dialogue conferences. Look, Islam has still not had a reckoning with its culpability as far as dhimmitude is concerned. So they need to own the culpability. The problem is this reckoning has been deflected, A, by the Marxist leftist thesis that it's all been the fault of the imperial West, principally the United States, and this in academia lately, since the late Edward Said, this has been reinforced by the so-called post-colonial interpretation of history, which sees lays all the blame on the wicked imperialist colonialist West. This, unfortunately, plays into the hands of delaying this long-awaited reckoning. This is, again, I think we hear a lot about Islamophobia. I think largely that's a media canard. You know, the Bishop Michael just said, and it's documented, that the most persecuted group in the world today are Christians. There is such a thing as Christophobia. With every rising of the sun, Jesus and his mother are maligned in all kinds of ways all over the world. The difference, of course, is that you don't see hordes of Christians rushing into the streets to start killing and... These were some thoughts that were triggered by what Dr. Eibner just said.
Bishop Michael.
Yes, thank you. The longest colonialism that most of the Islamic world and even Southern and Central Europe have seen is, of course, the Ottoman Empire. And the claim of the Ottoman ruler to be caliph was built on expansionism because he was the only... I mean, what right has a jumped-up Turkish chief to claim to be the caliph? He's not of the Quraysh. He was not an Arab. But he justified it because of the expansionist policies of the Ottomans. So when we talk about empire, I mean, Edward Said or not, you know, which empire are we talking about? Dialogue does make a difference sometimes. It depends on the kind of dialogue. I mean, I don't believe in kissy-kissy dialogue, you know, sort of where you sort of pat each other on the back and, you know, that's it. But in my experience, I was the leader of our church's dialogue with Al-Azhar al-Sharif in Cairo for many years, and our discipline was that each side could name one subject. So, 1 year, the Muslim side wanted the dialogue to be about the Danish cartoons, and so we had that. And our subject that year was Mr. Abdul Rahman. Mr. Abdul Rahman was an Afghan who became a Christian and was promptly arrested and under Sharia law was sentenced to death. I am a friend of... one of the an Islamic Sharia lawyer who's also one of the writers of the new Afghan constitution. So I said to him, I said, Professor, the West is spending billions of dollars in Afghanistan. You are one of the writers of the Afghan constitution. How can it be that Mr. Abdul Rahman can be sentenced to death? You know what he said? He said, look, he said, Michael, we have done our best. We have even incorporated the UN Declaration on Human Rights into the Afghan constitution in its preamble. But, he said, but no one can trump Sharia. You see. This is also the case in Iran. There is no law against apostasy in Iran, as far as I understand it, Bishop. But again and again, the judges, in this case, the Fiqh Jafriya judges, are invoking Sharia law to try apostates and to sentence them in whatever way. So it depends on the kind of dialogue. I mean, I've been the former Grand Mufti of Egypt, Sheikh Ali Goma. He showed me how to write fatwas in his Darul Ifta. I can write you a fatwa if you want. but you see, again, he issued a fatwa that apostasy, irtidad or rida, is not punishable in this life. And for that, he lost his job. In today's Egypt, I mean, this is now with the Shia ulama, Bishop Azad and I have been in regular dialogue with the ulama of the holy city of Qom, and it has made a little difference, I think, to the Christians in Iran. A former student of mine, who is now one of the leaders in one of the big cities in Iran, sent me a message that, for your sake, he said, I will allow the ringing of bells in churches in that city. Now, you may say this is a ridiculous thing, but of course, under Sharia law, that is forbidden. There's a long history of churches not being able to ring bells in the Islamic world. So he's making a major concession. I mean, it may look small to us. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, really? All right. All right. Well, okay. Whatever the reason. I think the Sharia issue is a major issue. In the last 150 years, there's been considerable movement amongst the ulama on the nature of Sharia. So, Shah Waliullah of Delhi, a great Sharia expert, was already saying, I mean, he said this in the 18th century, that there is a difference between the eternal principles that are brought by a prophet, the eternal principles, asul, and the way in which those principles are implemented, which can differ from society to society, from time to time. Muhammad Abduh, the great Egyptian scholar, was also thinking in a very open way about Sharia. And after all, he is behind the Salafi movement. Muhammad Iqbal, the founder and the chief ideologue of Pakistan, similarly had a developmental attitude to Sharia. But in the last 50 years, all this discussion has been completely closed down. I don't know why, maybe oil money, in favor of a humbly Wahhabi interpretation. Why is this? I mean, why have the Hanafites and the Shafi'ites and the other schools of law, why are they so quiet? This, unless this debate is opened in the Islamic world, we won't get anywhere. You know, what is the nature of Sharia in its relationship to political and economic issues in a country or even more than that? The moderates are made to shut up because of the appeal to the tradition that Professor Malik was talking about, that there is something there to which the radicals are appealing, which the moderates cannot gainsay. And, you know, this is worrying, very worrying. In the end, I mean, we come back to Professor Malik's father. In the end, the test for freedom must be the Article 18 test. Nothing less than that. Okay, we are willing to talk incrementally and deal with people and so on, but in the end, the test is Article 18. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bishop. Just before I take questions, I want to draw attention to latecomers, to wonderful human rights activists who received a human rights award last night from Secretary Pompeo, and I think their tardiness is due to having a meeting with Mike Pence. So we forgive you for your late arrival, but Pascal Warda, William Warda, founders of the Hammurabi Human Rights Organization.
Mabruk jiddan.
Okay, Joel. So, a question for you, or a comment, question?
Yeah, I have a question. My name is Jacob Rudenstrand. I come from Sweden. I work for the Evangelical Alliance there. I think it was you, Bishop, that mentioned about the silence of many churches in the West. And as a fellow European, the Church of Sweden, which is a Lutheran body, probably the largest Lutheran body in the world with 6 million members, have been criticized many times for being silent on persecuted Christians in the Middle East. They, in response, have said that the churches that they are in contact with want them to be silence, not to be as vocal, but to work under the radar. I would like to have your comments in the panel on that response. Should they be more vocal than they are?
Yeah, I think this may be an opportunity to draw your attention to this report. This is the independent review of the British foreign policy that was issued only a few days ago. And this question is discussed in this report. And what this report says, rightly, I think, is that there are always people in any country, Christian leaders or whoever, who have been co-opted into the establishment. I don't want to use the word bought because it's not always money. It's position, it's prestige, and all of those things. And it is not in their interest to rock the boat, you see. But they are not the only voices. The church in Sweden or any other church or any other group should be listening to those who are at the sharp end, who are actually suffering persecution. So take the case of India. I mean, now the mainline Indian churches are screaming about persecution, but for a long time they've been silent about persecution of evangelicals in India because it didn't suit them to rock the boat. So I would say don't just listen to the leader or to one group or to a privileged group, but listen more widely to what is being said. Also, you can be advocates in a way that doesn't identify a particular group so that they are further victimized. It is quite possible to do that. So for instance, about the blasphemy law in Pakistan, I mean, this can be taken at the level of legality alone, of human rights alone. I mean, you don't need to compromise the Christian leadership in Pakistan or the Christian community to raise questions about the blasphemy law.
Yeah, I would add to this that one of the reasons for the silence is a kind of themification. Now, in the subjugated, themified Christian communities of Muslim-majority countries, we understand why there's silence. This is part of the intimidation that comes with themitude. Unfortunately, the later development is that this kind of themitude has spread to the West as well, for a variety of reasons. You know, it's very, very strange, but I was at a conference some years ago in Krakow in Poland, the hometown of Pope John Paul II. Mm. And it was a conference about stereotypes. Interesting. So I sat there for 2 days and heard every conceivable kind of stereotype being discussed. And then I, in front of 350 people, I raised my hand and said, you know, there's one profile I haven't heard anything about. Someone who is white, male, Christian, heterosexual. I've said these four words and the place exploded. It's as if I mentioned the name of the devil. And for like the next 5 minutes, all sorts of abuse was hurled at these four words and at me. And when things started to quiet down, I finally said, thank you very much, I got my answer. But you see, this is the nature of the pathology that has kind of crept into free societies, you see? And I think that's part of the reason why you have silence. I'll just say that.
Very good.
This gentleman, excuse me, this gentleman with the white shirt.
Ayman, yeah.
Hello, my name is Ayman Abdennour. I'm the director of Syrian Christian for Peace. So our voice should be heard. And I was really astonished about what His Excellency Bishop Michael said about Syria. And I know the father-in-law of Bashar, who is a very wealthy man in London. I meet with you a lot, but that should not leave us, our voice outside. Take our voice also with you. Number one, I like that you condemned the Saudi plane that they bombed the kids, but also the Syrian military plane that bombs our people and killed 1 million. This is documented here and in every, even in British. This is why the FCO didn't like you to go there to see. 1 million person killed, military plane and long range missiles. So this is, you cannot use it against, even if there's 10,000, you cannot use it. Otherwise, we're asked to bomb London, but to follow 10 terrorists who are bombing some bus in London. The second issue, I like that you said that this Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, that they have, they believe them when they say nonviolence, and then you discover they are, this is all mistakes, and this is try to bluff. I assure you, I know all the people you met, all of them. I played with them, studied with them. The highest one, the number one, the number one. I know him for 18, 20 years. So I know what he's thinking and what we trained to talk to you. And the stages that what they ask to talk to you, I can bring one of them, if they ask here, and give him asylum to say near what they told to tell you, to tell you. If you are ready to change your opinion, this is what is going on. You cannot take, if you invite them to go to Syria to see, do you think that anyone will meet with them, not under surveillance, and he's forced to say, and he has, including the patriarchs, we know them, I met them when they came here 2 years ago. They told me this is the paper that we can see. I told them, why you don't see this, say this and this in front of the people? This is the paper, it's written. So this is why the Pope kicked one of them last year. The Malkite, Roman Malkite. Because he was praised the president more than Jesus, and we don't accept that at all. Jesus is God.
Thank you very much. Want to reply?
Yes, I mean, we are not, I am certainly not endorsing any particular regime or anyone like that. But in Syria, I've been to Syria many times. Of course, you live there, sir. There are many different voices. I have been to the IDP camps. I've been to many churches, not just the patriarchs, but many churches. Harut Salimian, the leader of the Armenian Evangelical Church, was here. I think he's left today. Has he left today?
Yes, he left this morning.
I've been to many cities. I've been to the town of Malula, and I've talked to ordinary people in their homes. So, of course, I don't know if Professor Malik agrees with this, but my own view is in the Middle East, as far as political leadership is concerned, there are no angels. No angels. There are only monsters.
That's putting it mildly.
Well, I was going to say, there are only monsters. But who is the lesser monster? I think this is also a question we have to ask. The stories I've been told again and again by ordinary Christians about what was done by Tahrir al-Sham, or when they were called Jabhat al-Nusra, well, I mean, why should these ordinary people make up these stories? There is no reason whatever. So I think that is what we have to listen to. I hope that in Syria in the future, and I've said this publicly, that there will be a new consensus. I also met with the internal opposition. I couldn't meet with the extremists because, of course, I wouldn't be here today if I had met them. I'd be somewhere much nicer.
with the two bishops, wherever they are.
Yes, right. Yeah, well, yes, indeed. What Ibrahim, you mean? Yeah.
The two bishops, he's my father. Yes. And Ibrahim is the father, and he asked me to form this before he was kidnapped.
Yeah.
No, there's no one can say he was kidnapped by the ISIS or the Islamic radicals, fanatics. Okay. No one can prove it. He's a US citizen, and we are supporting now with the FBI working together to see how can we free him.
Well,
we cannot claim.
Whoever has done it, the bishops have been kidnapped and they're not there.
Okay. Thank you. Did you want to comment? Then this gentleman was next.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Frank Gaffney. Right. I'm with Save the Persecuted Christians and wanted to just say this is as impressive a panel as I've ever been in on this topic. And I only wish your voices had been heard at the ministerial. Because I, like you, I think, was treated to an incessant campaign that seemed calculated to promote the idea that not only is the Christian persecution problem not as you've described it, but the real problem is what's being done to Muslims who are victims.
Yeah.
And I so appreciate, Bishop, your particular comment of the need for proportionality.
Yeah.
This seemed completely absent, and I wish I could say that this was just an oversight. It seems to me this was by design. Mm-hmm. And the design is one that is, I'm afraid, coursing through the whole interfaith dialogue enterprise. Mm-hmm. And I just have to say, I'm concerned as we see this being built into sort of a cottage industry now. By the U.S. government, by the International Religious Freedom Roundtables, and so on, that unless there's a principle that if your practice of your religion freely does not entail the limitation of other people's practice of their religion freely, you don't qualify for advocacy of or, you know, an honored place at the table of International Religious Freedom Advocates. A suggestion. If I may, just one last point. In holding people accountable, with which I hope we would all agree, the persecutors most especially, we have introduced an idea, coalition of ours, Faith McDonald, very active in it, to hold the enablers of those who persecute as well accountable. And we have a candidate, Squire Patton Boggs, very prominent firm here in Washington, D.C., that is kind of the 800-pound gorilla in the lobbying on behalf of, in their case, Communist China, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Cameroon, and the Palestinian Authority, all of which have in common, of course, their state sponsors of persecution. So I offer that as a target for a focused campaign of exposure and a call, as we've suggested in a petition that's now being circulated, that they be invited to stop representing these people, of course, but if they don't, that the president, his cabinet officers, and not least the Congress, decline to meet with the firms that are enabling this kind of persecution and their clients. Thank you.
Thank you. Did you want to comment?
Hello, Frank. Thank you. I'm one of your fans. Let me just say that, yes, much of it may be, as you said, by design, but a good deal of it is due to ignorance. These are not easy issues for government functionaries to actually fathom that easily. For example, this whole idea of democracy, you know, democracy has been exported to places like the Middle East in a very faulty fashion. In other words, there has not been enough attention paid to the difference between the formal side, which is campaigns, elections, one man, one vote, majority rule, and the values side, which is the substantive side, which is respect for rights, minority rights, and so on. Bishop Michael alluded to the tyranny of the majority, something right out of Tocqueville, of course. But Tocqueville knew this nuance. Government functionaries don't. And when you only export democracy in its formal rubric to a place like the Middle East, you're actually reinforcing what the majority has been doing for centuries, which is relegating those who are different to second-class status, et cetera, et cetera, in the name of democracy. And that's why we get this awful outcome, which is one man, one vote, one time. So, I mean, you know all of this. I'm just saying it for the benefit of others. Education and getting people who actually know these issues in depth would help formulate much more nuanced policies, I think.
Yeah. Sorry, were you going to say that?
No. Just to...
Going back to Frank, I came here thinking that Christians were the most persecuted people on earth. But in the last 2 days, I've discovered that it's actually Muslims who are the most persecuted people on earth.
Thank you. We have only about 15 minutes left, and I want to go in the order of hands that have gone up. This gentleman in the blue, the gentleman in the back, and Faith, and then if we have time, gentleman next to Faith, and then William.
Thank you. My name is Wael Aleji, and I lead research and advocacy.
The people cannot hear you. If you could speak up. Right.
My name is Wael Aleji, and I lead research and advocacy on the Middle East and North Africa at Christian Solidarity Worldwide, CSW. My question is to my favorite bishop, Bishop Nazir-Ali. Although we disagree on Syria slightly, but you are still my favorite bishop. My question is that, are we facing a clash of civilizations, regardless of Christian persecution in the Muslim world? Clearly, there is a crisis within the house of Islam. Christianity and Judaism went through a process of reformation. Is this possible in Islam? And if it is possible, what Muslims should and can do?
Yes, I mean, this is a question that is often, it was addressed to me,
yes,
a question that is often raised. And of course, the answer is that there have been many reformations or attempted reformations in Islam. So I mentioned the Kharijis. I mean, that was an attempted reformation, whatever we may think about it. Then the rise of tasawwuf, of Sufism, was also a kind of reformation. Muhammad Iqbal gives a number of reasons why Sufism arose, and one of them was the way in which the caliphates became very worldly. The most important reformation from our point of view in Islam was that of Ibn Taymiyyah. So all the Wahhabis, the Salafis, all go back to Ibn Taymiyyah. That is the tradition which is being appealed to. And of course, that leads back to Ibn Hanbal, at least. The question is, are there other kinds of reformation possible in Islam? I think there are. I mean, on the Sharia question, I have referred you to, Shah Waliullah, Muhammad Abduh, Muhammad Iqbal, all these people who were thinking progressively about Sharia, which is the key issue, of course, which has all been suppressed. After Maududi and Qutb, this whole discussion about Sharia has been suppressed. I think it needs to be reopened. People like Ali Goma, who reopened it, have also been suppressed. But it should be reopened. reformation of that kind is possible, but again, you see, you need freedom for that to happen.
Are you optimistic?
No.
You want to come in? Let me. Well, I think the bishop will agree that on a spiritual level, a Christian cannot but be optimistic. Things are going to get much worse before they get better, I think.
Well, I was
in that sense, he's not optimistic.
I was this specific matter, yeah.
But let me just, in answer to your question, let me just add another sort of layer here. One of the developments in modern times that has delayed or really deflected what you're hoping for, which is a kind of a reformation, has been the colossal failure of Arab intellectuals in the 20th century when it came to what they borrowed from the West. They borrowed actually socialism and nationalism. Mm. And then they tailored them for purposes of the Arab context. And that eventually produced the military dictatorships at mid-century, which began to repress everyone, and that, of course, again, in kind of Hegelian dialectical terms, brought about the backlash of the Islamists. So there was no chance for reform to show up. And the problem, again, is that every time Arab intellectuals tried to look in the direction of liberal democracy, they were told, no, this comes from the imperialist US. They were told this by the Marxists and the leftists and everybody. The Ba'athists are simply the Middle Eastern version of this faulty borrowing. Because what did socialism do in the West? The slippery slope is that socialism led to communism. What did nationalism do in the West? The slippery slope is that it led to fascism and Nazism. You don't borrow and then refashion in a soil that is not equipped to understand where these ideologies are leading, and then you reject out of hand liberal democracy. Why? Because its source has been demonized. That's what happened.
Could I be optimistic?
Yes, we will allow it, Bishop. But excuse me, we're running out of time.
Yeah, I just want to claim optimism. I think the Nahda did result in fascism. I mean, Ba'athism is a kind of fascism. But there were some features of the Nahda which could be used. I mean, for instance, the redefinition of Arab identity, that Arab identity had to do with its cultural and historical origins rather than with religion, even though Islam was given a place in it. And of course, many of the intellectuals of the Nahda were Christians, I mean, as it happened. Yeah, absolutely, yes, or Alawa, yeah. So I think, to be optimistic, There are seeds in the Nahda tradition that could be used. I agree totally with Professor Malik that what actually happened was a kind of socialistic Ba'athism that was picked out.
Thank you. The gentleman in the back had his hand up a long time ago.
Yeah, my name is Clint. I have no position. I have no position. I did live for 48 years in the Arab world. So out of this, I have problems actually with the title of the discussion. And that is Muslim extremism, that's on one side, and post-Daesh on the other side. The first is that it is my opinion that there really is a very clear spectrum that we're dealing with. I think the two speakers have adequately covered that. Just to say that the texts of Islam are a firm foundation for what the West would call extremism. And the moderates have failed for many reasons. I think Dr. Malik explained that, how the press sometimes thinks of Islamic extremism is some kind of revolt against Western imperialism. It's the blame casting And so my if we're looking at Muslim extremism in and of itself, it's too small of a thing to focus on. And the second is that I do not think that we can talk about post-ISIS, post-Daesh, any more than in Abdel Nasser's day they talked about post-Ikhwan Muslimin, because the Ikhwan Muslimin simply went underground. And that is what is going to happen in Sisi's Egypt, and that is what's going to happen throughout the Levant, and wherever Daesh has taken hold, it will simply go underground and actually come up even more powerful than before. So somehow I think we need to address the question differently. And I have optimism, but I have no optimism whatsoever in political process. The U.S. has never had a clearly defined Middle Eastern policy because of internal politics. But my optimism rests on the information revolution that is being made available in the Muslim world, where we see so many people actually leaving Islam. The only problem is the ones that will remain are the ones that we call the extremists.
Thank you very much. I take full responsibility for the title. I may just say that the post-Islamic or post-ISIS world, of course, I think has been addressed. I mentioned that it is underground, but we are told that it's been defeated. And that is the message that has gone to the general public.
Well, I would agree with that with one footnote. Right. This has no connection with reality. This statement has no connection.
Okay, right. Okay. Faith.
Hi, Faith McDonald from the Institute on Religion and Democracy. And I want to go back to what you were saying, especially Dr. Malik, about the State Department, whoever, being ignorant on this. I think maybe there is some ignorance, but I think there is also more of a deliberate effort on some people's part. But my question is, there's no reason for them to be ignorant because in the International Religious Freedom Act, which is the law of the land now, one of the provisions was that foreign officers should be trained to understand the importance of religion around the world, to understand what religious persecution was. John, you and I, and Elaine, we were all part of working to get the International Religious Freedom Act passed, and that was a very important part of it that has never been used. My question is, do you think instead of having things like the ministerial, which was a nice big love fest, that it would be better to spend some funds in the International Religious Freedom Office on training foreign service officers and actually the staff right there in the State Department on the issue of the importance of religion to people and also on the persecution issue more clearly?
That's a very good question. I heard Ambassador Sam Brownback make a very interesting suggestion at the ministerial, which is that several roundtables should be established around the world to discuss religious freedom issues as they pertain to those areas. Well, there's nothing wrong in establishing roundtables right here in Washington, so that some of the, as you mentioned, those who work in the State Department, diplomats and so on, would be better informed and educated. These are difficult issues with many nuances, and the nuances matter.
To the kind of situation that we've seen, and I fear roundtables will be only certain people in certain countries, and the whole DIMI attitude will continue. I mean, I heard they want to start one in Sudan, and I just laughed at that.
Well, listen, a round table needs to have experts, credible experts at the table. Otherwise, it's going to become, it'll devolve into a kind of a circus. And people have to listen to the experts. And there are experts on these issues. I mean, it's very important for, I'll just give a quick example, but there are hundreds of these examples. It's very important to understand, for instance, that the default of Islam and the default of Christianity are very different. Mm-hmm. With Islam, the default is religion and politics are fused. Yeah. In Christianity, they are separated. The problem is, historically, it took Christians 1,500 years to realize that what they'd been doing was a departure from the default, and they came back to the default. But there was a default to come back to. So this is one nuance. Another one. Christianity doesn't have a theology of place, thankfully, and in a very liberating way. What does that mean? Of course, there are holy places. If anything, the Christian view must regard these places as extremely important because God himself was incarnated and walked there. But the reason they are holy is infinitely more important than the places, number one. And number two, a believer can have a personal relationship with that reason anywhere in the universe. So this idea of having to control a piece of real estate politically, otherwise something will jeopardize one's salvation, this is un-Christian. But unfortunately, it's Islamic and Jewish. So there are these nuances that need to be internalized. These are just two examples.
Yeah, I think the other thing is language. I mean, Christianity has no sacred language. It has original languages, but no sacred language, so it's translatable into every culture. What I wanted to say in response to faith is that my fear is that if your diplomats, etc., become religiously literate, that religious literacy will then be used to serve the U.S.'s geopolitical ends. I mean, that is. It seems to me that we are transitioning from a general U.S. position that religion should not in any way be recognized in terms of its of the U.S.'s dealings with other states, to a position where FORB, freedom of religion and belief, can be instrumentalized to deliver U.S. foreign policy. Now, that's a blunt point, but that's how it came over to me.
I just add my own little footnote to that. Of course, it is nothing new that religion has been instrumentalized. I mean, it was during the Cold War. I mean, there's no secret about the fact that part of the liberation effort for the communist world involved freedom of religion. I go back even further to a case in Iran when there was the overthrow of the Mossadegh government. If you read the foreign documentation, the new volume of the Foreign Relations of the United States for that period, you'll find the very interesting CIA cable back to Washington. They don't know how it's going to turn out. They're getting nervous, and they say, Washington, please do 1, 2, 3, 4. One of the points that they wanted Washington to do was to get the Shiite Ayatollahs and the holy sites in Iraq to declare jihad against the Mossadegh. Mossadegh and Afghanistan. There is a lot of knowledge here in Washington about religion, the power of religion, and how it can be used for better or worse. Sometimes American foreign policy coincides with promotion of religious freedom. It ends well. Eastern Europe is a great example of that, but there are other cases when it has not. We have our guest from Iraq, the Human Rights Religious Freedom Prize winners. We heard yesterday from William about how there is no democracy in Iraq, there is no religious freedom of worship, but not freedom of practice. after the country has been liberated and in the name of democracy and human rights. There's a lot of knowledge about religion in Washington, D.C., and it is used for various purposes. This gentleman next to Faith was the next one to have a question or a comment.
Thank you very much. I am really excited about all of this that I've been learning through this conference in the past couple of years. I was on the persecutor side till 25 years ago. I've become on the persecuted side. I'm a Palestinian native, but American citizen, and I was one of Yasser Arafat's hitmen, and persecuted Christians as well as Jews, and came to know Jesus 25 years ago through a vision. And I see this coming more and more often, and I hear more about Muslims converting, and I think this extremism of Islam is helping actually the Muslims themselves to open their eyes to see the truth about Islam itself. And so this is really an exciting part, and looking at this conference and seeing the so many modest Muslims that have been sitting and listening, attending this conference, it's exciting to me. I'm in the field of reaching Muslims for Christ. And I'm a businessman and also turned into the NGOs to help persecuted churches within the Middle East area, especially as a Palestinian in the West Bank and Israel, and working on the reconciliation work between Christians, between Arabs and Jews. The thing that I have noticed within the conference itself is the issue of the converted Muslims that are being persecuted within the Middle East. And I have been under attempt of assassination personally many, many times. Having been trained as an assassin myself, I think helped me to escape many of these attempts. But even my own family have sent after me. And that particular, Bishop, when you say the Muslims are ones more persecuted, I'm sorry.
I was being sarcastic.
So I think in the next conference, we should be looking at that particular point, because there are more Muslims converting to Christianity and being persecuted, and many of my friends have been killed because of their faith, Christianity, conversion.
Thank you very much. Do you want to comment on this observation, Bishop?
No.
Then the very last question, this gentleman.
Thank you. My name is Daska Sherwani, and I work for KRG, Director for Religion and Minority. I agree with the doctor about education, West. I disagree with him. For last thing, I disagree with him. I will say, Darwin, because I agree with you, education 100%, education the foundation to change the whole system and the people. Because with the education, you educate people. Neighbor, I grew up since my grandfather, we had a good relation with the Jews when they were in Iraq, when the Kurdistan, and then the Christian. So we never had a problem because we were a neighbor, like you said. But the education used to be teach you how everybody is bad except your religion. And I think that in the Kurdistan did the right thing, change the religion, studying Islamic religion to study religion. Now in the Kurdistan they teach Christian, all different religions, Christianity, Muslim, Baha'i, Yazidis. So you just don't study Muslim, which is, I think, is great. But I disagree with you about the West. Last time the Iraqi wrote the constitution, Kurd don't want to say every U.S. Iraqi law have to be balanced with the Sharia. It means it's no democracy. We disagree. We could fight them. But then we were forced to accept that constitution because U.S. wanted to be passed. And the Iraqi constitution, we cannot make any law in the Kurdistan. We have to go by Iraqi constitution. And in Iraqi constitution, everything is by Sharia. So it's not, and Bishop, I disagree with you. The Islamic party is good as long as they don't have a power. When they have power, they will kill you. So I disagree with you, all of them too. It's no, none of them is angel, none of Islamic parties. They all, if they have power, they kill you. We as a Kurd, we have experience with it.
Thank you very much. Final comments?
Well, if I'm not sure I exactly understood where we disagree, but yeah. Look, clearly the West is not free of faults. And clearly there is plenty of constructive criticism to be done there. The problem is that this has gone overboard with a kind of self-flagellation that has given the native culpability a pass, a break. And that was basically what I was trying to say.
Yeah, I think what I said about Muslims being the most persecuted people in the world, this was istalamtu at-tans, you know, I mean, I was, yes, yeah, I was being sarcastic or, yeah, ironic. So,
yeah. On that note, we'll draw these proceedings to a close. Thank you so much for joining us for this very lively, I think, enlightening conversation. Many thanks.
Salam, sir.